Friends, welcome to the 89th session of Legal Empowerment Through Interaction Lecture Series. Thanks to Justice Roshan Dalvi, we have a wonderful speaker today, Justice Manju Goyal. And today we also have the presence of Justice Ramkumar sir and all of you wonderful participants. We are going to deal with a wonderful topic, maybe at times not palatable to many of us, but still very essential for all of us. Let us discover what ought to be and what is the ethics for lawyers. Over to you, ma'am.
Okay. Well, I begin with namaskar. Welcome, Justice Ramkumar.
Okay, thank you.
My dear friend Roshan Dalvi and Prem Raj, the initiative for today's talk, and all others who are present, some are visible, some are invisible. I welcome everyone to this talk. Now, as Mr. Prem Raj just now said, it is unpalatable to talk about ethics. A very similar situation I faced when I went to an academy where government officers, executive officers were there to have their usual training. And the topic for me was ethics. And they were rather, you know, they were quite cross. Why ethics to us? As if nobody needs any lesson in ethics. Now, there is an age-old ethical principle, Satyam Vada. I don't think anybody has any quarrel with this, Satyam Vada. Then the next rule is Priyam Vada. No problem. But sometimes you are confronted with Satyam Apriyam. So what do you do? Now, this is an ethical question. Okay, you don't have to be dishonest. And dishonesty or corruption, that is not the subject matter of today's discussion at all. So discussion is about ethics and particularly keeping in view the fact that this is a group of lawyers and the lawyers also need to be talked to about ethics. Not that I'm assuming that they need it, but they may not need the training in ethics, but the discussion on ethics is essential.
The do's and don'ts.
Pardon?
The do's and don'ts.
And don'ts, and particularly at least an attitude to give it a thought. You know, so I am just provoking the thoughts, not like a godman giving out sermons. I'm just like an equal. I'm just throwing some thoughts for their examination, for their ponderance. Okay. Now, first thing to be understood is why we are talking of X. Now, I found three reasons. One is that we have become an open society. Everybody wants to know what everybody else is doing and why. Right? We want to question anybody and everybody. Now, even if I don't know anything about the space research, if something goes wrong, I'm there to, you know, point a finger to Dr. Sivan that he must have done some mischief, that space mission has failed. So this openness in the society and our being subjected to all kinds of criticism requires us to act in such a way that we look above board. Even if we are above board, we must look above board. That is the need of the time. The second is, of course, the falling standard of ethics. And the third, which is most important, because we need an identity of the group. We need an identity of what is the moment you say lawyer, people have an idea as to what kind of a person you are. And this image is not of you particularly. The image is of the lawyers as a group. So do we need to do something to improve the image of the lawyers? Just as we are doing this exercise in judicial academies repeatedly, you know, judicial ethics. Why? Because as a group, we want to present to the society that we are sincere, reasonable, hardworking, very nice people. Society can rely. So this image building is very important when we talk about ethics. Now, commission between right and wrong. This is disappearing. What is right and what is not right? For example, I tell you, I went to a memorial ceremony. Somebody had died. He was an employee of the municipal corporation. So people were naturally speaking in praise. And one of them said, whoever visited his office was always obliged, and the man did not even charge too much of money. Now you see, thus corruption has become virtue. In public, in a gathering like this, somebody is speaking out, saying he was a very nice much of money. So this is how dishonesty has become a virtue. He is a nice man, kind man. So he can help people by misusing his office. It's fine. There was a debate going on between a group of government servants. The topic was whether speed money is legal or illegal. You know what is speed money? Speed money is money or bribe that you pay for getting things done which you are entitled to. The officer knows that it is your entitlement. He has to give you the permission or license. But unless that speed money comes to his pocket, he will not do. So he has not done anything illegal, not misused his office. He has used his office. But he has earned some bribe. So is it good? Nobody is ashamed that this is something unethical. Now, today, I will not discuss those Bar Council of India rules. Audience can always read. And they don't say everything that is required to be said. I will rather talk generally about the ethical principles that we all have to follow. Now, we have three different situations in life. One is our personal situation, where we go by our own moral convictions, what is good and what is not good. In society, we see what is good to live as a member of the society. Where should I park my car? Where should I throw my garbage? How loudly should I play my music? How to handle my pets? You know, how to address my neighbor? These are realities in social life, and we have some ethical principles for such situations. Professional ethics generally is guided by rules, regulations. Sometimes they are written in books, or sometimes they are developed as a matter of convention. Now, when it comes to professional ethics, then we again have to be careful as to what we are. How do we want the society to perceive us, or how does the society actually perceive us? That has to be kept in mind. Now, what is a profession? So I looked up and I found Roscoe Pound has something to say, that famous intellectual jurist. He says historically there are three ideas involved in a profession: organization, learning, and a spirit of public service. So I repeat, organization, learning, and a spirit of public service. Then he goes on to say these are essentials. The remaining idea of gaining livelihood is incidental. So we are lawyers as a group, as a professional, right? And we are not pursuing it as a means of earning livelihood. earning livelihood is incidental, that we will. Okay, so Roscoe Pound goes on to explain the difference between a profession and a trade. The profession is working for the benefit of the mankind, and the trade is working for the benefit of the individual trader. So a trader has to do everything, honest or dishonest, whatever he does, his ultimate aim is to gain some profit. And when a lawyer works, good or bad, he works with an idea of helping mankind. Now, as I said, you know, I can give living example. You are all living examples. If you look back and think of the cases that you have done so far, if I ask an, you know, grand old lawyer, tell us some stories from your own professional life, I'm sure he is going to tell us stories of cases in which he made a point. He could convert a judge's yes into no, or judge's no into yes. Or he could bring a smile on the lips of a desolate widow. He will tell us those stories. He will not tell us stories in which he made much money. And if I ask any one of you, narrate a good story, you will not tell me those stories where you made money. You will tell me stories, am I correct? You will tell me stories where you did some very good work. And good work not for self-aggrandizement. Good work for the benefit of another person. Whether you see the society in him or her or not is another matter. You see, our lawyer who was pleading that Jadhav's case, Kulbhushan's case, he did not charge the government even a penny. So why didn't he charge? He could charge. His Pakistani counterpart charged a huge amount of money to the government. Now, our lawyer did not charge. The work is reward. Isn't the work reward? So this is the difference between profession and trade. Now, lawyers are known as, you know, they are a learned profession. Doctors, we say, are a noble profession. Why are lawyers a learned profession? Is it because they have to get an LLB degree to start practicing? No, they are a learned profession because they have to be in continuous process of learning. Continuously, they have to learn, which of course, in today's time, includes unlearn. The old things that my senior has taught no more valid today, so I have to learn something new and forget something old. So this, principle of Upanishad, you know, charaiveti, go on and on and on, applies here. Don't stop at what your guru has taught you. There is truth even beyond what the guru has taught. And the guru is asking you, don't stop. Charaiveti is an instruction coming from a guru. I have told you all that I know, but you don't think this is the end. Go on and on. So this principle has to be maintained by lawyers to be called a learned profession. That is why they are a learned profession. They have to increase the general pool of knowledge. They have to increase their own knowledge. They have to improve the application of the newfound knowledge. That is why they are a learned profession. And how do they serve the society? You will say, okay, it's a client. He is there to help the client. You see, to the client, he is the face of the court. The client may not know what happens in the court. He looks at you as if you are the court. It appears, the court looks at the lawyer. He is the one to tell us what is happening or what the society wants or what is the grievance of the society. So he is the face of the society before the court. So now we call him an officer of the court. He is not an insignificant cog in the wheel of justice delivery system. He is an officer of the court. And if he is an officer of the court, he actually holds a public office. And if he holds a public office, then I will recall all the principles of ethics given by Nolan. The seven principles of Nolan, I will say, they are selflessness, integrity, objectivity, accountability, openness, honesty, and leadership. I will repeat: selflessness, integrity, objectivity, accountability, openness, honesty, and leadership. Now, what is selflessness? I'll not go into each of them. Now, selflessness means what? Not that you will not take your fee, you will take your fee. But what you are carrying is the client's interest, not your own interest. If you think your name, fame, your things, they come first, then you cease to be selfless. You take what is incidental to your work, but you are selfless by carrying forward the interest of your client, not your own interest. You see, now let us say Nirav Modi. Is he not entitled to legal advice? Can I not be his lawyer? Is it unethical to become his lawyer? Some lawyer certainly is behind his brain telling him how to avoid the law. No, that is not ethical lawyering. Ethical lawyering certainly will mean that we give him the right kind of advice. Can I take him out of his indebtedness? Can he pay back? Can he survive? Where has the money gone? Why is he unable to pay? As a lawyer, if I can assist, it will certainly be ethical lawyering. Now, what is our main aim? When we work, the client's interest is one thing, but the main aim, why we exist in the society, is resolution of dispute. We are here to resolve the disputes. Okay, so this we have to keep in mind. Are we feeding on the problems of the society, or we are there to reduce the problems of the society? Now, Mr. Premraj, can we show the first question?
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah, 1 second.
There is a practical issue.
No, absolutely no issue.
No, it's being put. It's being displayed. It's displayed, madam.
Just the first question.
Just could you lower it down, Shyamata? Could you just lower it a bit?
Mr. Premraj, can you read that?
Yeah, I will read it for you. Question number one. A poor woman has come to you with a grievance that her husband has turned her out of the house but has retained the child who is fine and that she is in dire need for money. From what different angles will you examine her case before advising for or against legal action? Is any ethical principle involved in your work? Now, any of the two or three partakers can answer this question. And then it will be up for Justice Manju Dalvi to come. Justice Manju Goyal to come in. Any of two or three of our partakers, they can answer. Kindly raise your hands.
We want to discuss the different angles. No, not your final decision. What are the different angles you will examine this case from? Who will answer?
Anybody who want to answer can unmute and answer.
Yeah, Shyam sir, I would like to give answer to this.
Yeah, sure.
If let us say the woman comes to me first, and if this is a situation, I will rather first write a notice to her husband and tell him that you are legally, you legally have to maintain her. And she is, since the child is still minor, below the age of 7 years, as per, I do not know the personal laws, she is entitled to the custody, being even the father is also legal guardian that is there. But again, I was of natural guardian. But I would have first sent in notice saying that you maintain her, that is a right, and you are must maintain her. And if he doesn't agree, then we would have taken the legal actions, whatever, as per the personal laws or under CRPC 125 or maintenance. That depends. Yeah. Thank you.
Now, is there any other person who has examined this and is in a position to answer, Mr. Premraj?
Yeah. Madam.
Now, Anuradha, please.
Yeah. Madam. Good afternoon, madam.
Yes.
What I have seen in this is, first, the lady is in a very, a pitiable condition, wherein she is deprived of her marital home and as well as the child, who is a minor.
Please be brief. I only want the angles from which the case has to be examined. Only the angles.
Okay. So, I would rather give a sort of moral support to her, saying that not to worry.
Yeah.
And leave the things apart. I would actually say her to be cool and then sort it out. That's what I could observe.
Okay, let me.
Thank you, ma'am.
My own reflections, and we will ask for Roshan Dalvi's expert comments. Well, I only want this ethical aspect. What does ethics for a lawyer give or guide? I got one very good answer to begin with that I'll give notice to the.
Hello. Hello.
Yes. Yes.
Hello.
Should I
continue? Hello.
Yeah, you're
audible, please.
Madam, I will first ask her to approach legal services authority first and give a petition, because there will be a mediation at the first time, and if it is not settled, we will ask her to file a petition under section 125 or DV Act or something else.
Okay. Now tell me, I will give my own impression when I find women in these kind of situations. What are the different things that a lawyer, keeping in mind the fact that he is a selfless person, not for his own benefit. Now the first thing to be noticed here, that it is a family dispute. There is a child which is involved. No, unfortunately, in our country, the child suffers when the parents fight, and the child does not even have a representation in court. So the first angle is to examine, is the breakup complete, or is there any scope of reconciliation? This is the first angle. Second angle, what is the level of bitterness between the husband and the wife? Must he see the husband behind the bars? And if she is very bitter, as an ethical lawyer, I will like her to know the fallout of making a police complaint and the consequences of the man being behind the bars. The third angle, what is her own income? What is the income of the husband? If the court passes an order of maintenance, which is very common, very easy to pass, is there any probability of recovering that maintenance awarded by the court? Because the main difficulty we see with judges is that the maintenance order is there, but the order is not actually executed. Then another angle was, could we do it outside court by sending a notice and asking the husband to resolve. Now, fifth angle is the custody of the child. Is he better off with the father, or must the mother must get the child? Because the our ultimate aim is to see the best interest of the child. The child is not necessarily best with the mother, although that is how we proceed. That is the first assumption. But now that the mother is home and the child has a home, maybe the grandparents, etc., are also there, maybe the child is better off there. So the mother must understand, or it is my duty as a lawyer to make her understand, that the interest of the child has to be also taken into consideration. Then I will consider whether she is in a position to pay the expenses of litigation. And if she is not able to pay the expenses of litigation, can I take her to the legal services authority? Then the next thing to examine is, if I take her to court, what is the time that I will take to get her some relief? Now, I have to inform her that I can do this for you, but I will take about 3 years relief from the court. Are you willing to wait? Are you in a position to sustain this struggle for that period? Then I might try to find out, what is her equation with her in-laws? Maybe the parents-in-law are good. Maybe she is in their good books. Has she taken their help? So these are the various angles. And I have to give her complete information so that she takes an informed decision. It's not nice to take a person to court immediately, when particularly a woman of this circumstances, to force her to court. So maybe the best of lawyer will not take this case to the court. Now, can I ask for Roshan's intervention?
Madam, you're on mute. Just unmute.
Yes. Okay?
Yeah.
Okay. Now, in a circumstance like this, I would see that there are three angles where she has missed out. She has been thrown out of the house. She has got no money. Her child is taken away from her. The first I would ask her is, what does she want? I would ask her, you name all the things that you want, and then I'll see what I can get for you. And I would impress upon her the value of life. Suppose she gets the child, but has to give up the maintenance. And if I can allow her to stand on her own 2 feet, I can make her stand on her own 2 feet or something like that. She gets the freedom away from this husband who has thrown her out. She gets certain person get maintenance. If she cannot do that, and if she has to apply for maintenance, I would say you will not be able to take care of the child particularly. You see that you meet the child, and I would like to make visitation rights better for her. So it is dependent essentially upon what that lady thinks is best for her, not what I think is best for her. And I would want to give her that.
I think it is very beautifully answered that yes, I gave 8 angles, but eventually if I give her all the options and she has to finally take a decision as to what she will do, she will certainly do what she likes best. But one can also begin with this standpoint, ask her, what do you think is best for you? And of course, the best course is to put her on her 2 legs, 2 strong feet, so that she is independent. And if she is independent, she can find all kinds of wards. You know, so long as she is dependent on this person or the other person, she is on the receiving end. So the best way is to empower the woman. This is the gist, I think, the spirit of Justice Roshan Dalvi's intervention. I proceed. The similar ethical issue we face when the media is questioning. The media has to be informed so very often about what the Supreme Court has said in a judgment or what the new law says. There is an amendment in a law which affects almost everybody. So what does this amendment say? Now, you know, you are sometimes okay with the amendment, sometimes not okay with the amendment. So what kind of attitude should the lawyer adopt? You know, when this triple talaq judgment came, one young Muslim lawyer framed just three paragraph, you know, gist of the judgments, saying that this is what the issue was and this is how the court has decided. It was such a marvelous, you know, contribution from the profession for the benefit of the society. I found a scholar speaking to students, and the scholar was criticizing a recent Supreme Court judgment. So at the end, I asked her, and I was told, no, she newspaper. Now here, this is wrong. You see, the judge has taken care to write out a judgment, knowing that this is going to create some controversy. A lot of care has been taken. We know we write judgments. In every judgment, we know there can be a controversy. We take care. And here it is a judgment in a controversial issue. The judge has taken care. So when you criticize a judge, I mean, you criticize a judgment rather, then you have to take as much care to criticize. Your criticism of the judgment, wrong judgment, should not be wrong. Now, I have framed one ethical question for you here. Please show the second question.
Shamara, just show the second question. Just a bit more down. Okay, that's okay. So I will read it for you. The media has invited you to comment on a judgment in a case of public interest. You are not happy with the judgment. What factors will you keep in mind in preparing your presentation? Again, two or three participants, they can raise their hands. Please raise your hands. Anybody?
Well, am I there?
Yeah, anybody can, because I enabled unmuting, you can unmute and definitely go ahead.
The media has commented on a judgment in a case of public interest. You are not happy with the judgment. What factors will you keep in mind in preparing your presentation?
First of all, madam, what I'll see is the judgment is about what? And secondly, what is actually the public interest involved into it? I would not only comment because I want to be in a public figure or I want to be more famous. While commenting onto it, I will see to it that the integrity of the nation, or rather because of my comment, no disturbance would happen. The integrity and again the independence of a judiciary, at the same time that dignity of the authority who passed the order, that should also be maintained with due respect. I would have the fair comment, but which would rather help that equity should prevail in such cases, and which would be that it could be in a position that it can be executed. I would not pass a comment which cannot be executed. I will see to it that it can be executed properly. The court again re-examine the facts and they could again come to the conclusion. And that is in the fair decision. And I would not see to it that I want to come into the public image and I want to be good, showing that I know big about, I mean, having a good knowledge of a thing or something like that. Thank you.
Any other view? By any participant? No? Well, we must know, there are two, criticizing a judgment and criticizing a judge. So as a ethical lawyer, I must not criticize the judge, I must criticize the judgment. But before I criticize the judgment, I should honestly state what the judgment says. I will not put wrong things in the judgment and then criticize. Like saying what the new law says, instead of saying what the new law actually says, people put in things in that. The new law will do this and new law will do that. So please state the facts honestly in a straightforward manner, that this was the fact, this is the judgment, and these are the reasons. Or this was the old law, this is the new amendment, and therefore how it stands with the amendment. Now there will be implications of the judgment and of the new law. Now when you say that these are the implications, please make it clear to the members of public that these are the implications which I think will be there, instead of saying it will necessarily be the implication. Because another person, because what you say is very important to the members of society who are not actually reading the judgment or reading the new law. So you are very, very important as an educator to the society, because what you say carries a lot of weight. Will Roshan enlighten us?
Well, I would not criticize the judge at all. There's no question. I would lay down the facts of the judgment and then I would say how it could have been better. Like we say now, amended CPC under Order 8, that when you deny, you have to say what is your defense? It's like that. So you have to actually show then what should have been the judgment and the reasons for it. It would make it transparent.
Absolutely.
And thereafter, I think if as a jurist, if you want to...
I think that's all I would want to say.
If a jurist wants to throw light, then the jurist has to say, I'm a jurist. And according to my wisdom, I think this is where the judgment has gone wrong, or this is what the consequence is going to be. But he must not say that the judge says something. We have to bring back the image of lawyers as a benevolent group. Are we the same people who sacrifice for the independence of the country? It was the lawyers, no? All through, from Mahatma Gandhi to Jawaharlal Nehru, Tej Bahadur Sapru, name anyone. They were all from legal profession. They sacrificed their professional interests, their personal interests, they sacrificed their families and worked for the country. Are we the same people, or we are, you know, out to make personal gains? Now, suppose a house owner says, you are a lawyer. You know, if the house owner thinks twice before taking you as a tenant, well, we have done something wrong somewhere. The lawyers must have done something wrong somewhere, so that the house owner has got this impression in his mind that it is not safe to induct a lawyer as a tenant. If the bank thinks twice before lending money to a lawyer, well, we also have to do some introspection. We'll fight for our rights, but that introspection is also very, very important. We have to do that. Now, another aspect of ethics is bar bench relationship. Because we work together, neither the judge nor the lawyer has any interest in the outcome of the case. I mean, if the client wins, it is the client that wins. The lawyer is not winning. And the judge in any case doesn't gain a pie, even if he passes a decree of crores of rupees. So they are working together for a cause. but still there are conflicts. So I I have chosen this third question for your consideration. What happens in this situation? Mr. Prem Raj, will you show the third question?
Sharada, kindly show the third question.
It's on the screen.
Yeah. A client wants to engage you in a case pending in court. You do not want to appear before the judge before whom the case is pending because he had offended you once in the recent past. What will you do? Who will answer?
I think now no takers.
No taker.
That might require a strong reply. So,
can I try to answer?
Yeah, please. Go ahead.
Somebody is here.
Yeah.
The thing is that first I will try to inquire that the case is pending. It means he may have an advocate before or he may not have made an advocate before. I will try to see the history of the case and I will try to find out why he wants to make me as an advocate to appear in that matter. Yeah. And then I'll go through the brief. At the same time, I'll be very honest enough to tell him. That is my personality, that I tell him, see, this has happened with me in the past and I really don't want to appear before this court. Usually we can't say so, because any which way we have to appear before the court since it is our need, and we also need clients and client also needs me. First, in fact, I would not do that, but if it says so, then I tell him because of he had offended me, I don't want to go before him. You may engage some other or I'll help you in getting a good advocate in there. That I will do, but I'll be honest enough to tell him this answer that this thing has happened in the past. Now I don't feel like appearing before this court.
Wonderful answer. Wonderful.
Any other view?
Nitin, if you inquire, you might find that he has got some suicide tendencies. That is why he wants to engage you only when the judge is antagonistic to you.
Maybe to tempt the judge to recuse.
No, there won't be any recusing. I mean, that is something different. But here, you got a judge, not necessarily on the wrong side, but still, who had offended you earlier, and the client particularly wants you. There is some malafides in it.
But the reason for offending him also may be relevant.
I know this is a very common question. It happens with any one of you. It has happened with me. A lawyer coming and saying, please transfer this case. I said, why? He said, I don't want to appear in your court. And he gave me some reason. Nothing personal, but he gave me some reason. I had spoken on some topic somewhere. He doesn't want to appear in my court. And I told him, well, I will not send my case to the district judge. If you want your case to go to some other court, then it is your duty to get it transferred. But I cannot send it to the district judge saying this lawyer doesn't want to appear in my court. So there are various ways of handling, but this is totally unethical. If you don't want to appear in the court, don't take the case. But if you take the case, you appear. You cannot say, come. So whoever wants the case to be transferred will come to you. And he will say, okay, engage this person. This judge has seen my case through and through. I'm not going to get anything here. I can't fool the judge anymore. Therefore, engage so and so. Well, I learned this theory of success of a lawyer. Never lose a case. Never lose a case. First principle. Prepare your case very well, read your brief, study the law, and be perfect. Don't lose a case. But if you lose a case, second is never lose a client. You be honest to the court, to the client. The client should have faith in you even if the client loses. So he will come back with another case or he will send others to you. So don't lose a client. This is the second principle. And the third, even if you have to lose a client, Don't lose the court. Because that is where you have to go day in and day out. So never lose a court. So this is where is question of attitude. The judge may have offended you and just may have forgotten whatever may have happened on that occasion. We don't carry things as a judge. I can say I don't carry anything in my mind. Tomorrow if the same lawyer appears or even on the same day in another case he appears, I'm not going to recall the previous incident of any animosity. And I think I'll be endorsed by Roshan Dalvi and Justice Ram Kumar. That we have nothing personal against the lawyer.
As a judge, I would say when I'm taught that I've offended anybody, it is because I've done what I think is my duty. And I forget about it. And if the same man comes again, I may give him an order. As a lawyer, I would say that this is a very fine opportunity for me to prove my worth. So I would take the case, I would really prepare well, so that the judge would then change his opinion about me.
That is in my hands
as a lawyer.
And this is the right spirit, This is another opportunity to appear before the same judge and this time impress him that I'm here, I am, the best of lawyers.
Yes.
This is important, the bar bench relationship, there is a kind of tussle in certain courts. But there is no need of a tussle because we are working for the same cause, for resolution of disputes, without looking at personal aggrandizement, neither the lawyer nor the judge. But if personal interest comes in of the lawyer, that I want to be great, everybody in the court should say, wow, he is honored by the judge in such and such manner, then there can be a conflict. But the lawyer should remember that the judges generally don't carry any opinion, any firm opinion, such that cannot be shaken. So in a court, if there is anything which has offended the lawyer, he should introspect, he should find out why I am offended. Should he at all have been offended? Should the judge have said what the judge should not have said? And is it an opportunity for me to correct the previous situation? I remember the case of a lawyer who was facing eviction proceedings in my court. So when I was ready to pass the judgment, he came to the court and he said he wants to meet me. I said, no, I will not meet you. So he came to the courtroom and he says, please don't pass the order. Give me 7 days. I said, what will you do in 7 days? He said, I'll vacate the house. I don't want to be evicted by the court. You see, his self-respect. I don't want to be evicted by the court. I will vacate the house. I know the case is against me. I'm going to lose it. So why not honorably vacate? See the personal conduct. The other day, in a similar situation, similar webinar, I was saying, if you are a good man at heart, if you are a very good man at core, those ethical principles need not be looked into at all. You can simply go ahead with the goodness in mind. So this is something to do with barman's relationship. Now, do I have some more time?
Yeah, definitely you have, ma'am.
Some more time, okay. Now, when it comes to judicial ethics, we refer to the Bangalore principles, which give us 6 core values. They are 1, independence, 2, impartiality, 3, integrity, 4, propriety, 5, equality, 6, competence and diligence. I'll repeat, independence, impartiality, integrity, propriety, equality. And the last is competence and diligence. Now, left to myself, I will put the sixth principle as the first principle. Competence and diligence. You have to work. The moment you assume the position of a judge, your first ethical principle is to work. And work as much as you can, work as efficiently as you can, and you continue reading yourself by reading law or reading other books and find out how best you can discharge your responsibility. I think, according to me, this is the first ethical principles. The rest, independence, impartiality will come only when you work. So, you know, this, as judges have to improve their diligence, and as lawyers who are a learned profession anyway, both have to improve the efficiency. Like in our shastras, they say yoga is karmeshu kaushalam. What is yoga? Is efficiency at work. Now, if it is efficiency at work, even, you know, from any other angle, you have to be efficient at work. It's not efficiency doesn't come naturally. Efficiency comes only when we want to be efficient and we do our best to acquire skill. So when we acquire skill, we become efficient. Now, fortunately for us, we have the judicial academies where we go, we share our, we, I think, give some wisdom to the younger ones and we learn something in return. For the lawyers, I think in Kerala there is an organization, but in the rest of the country, there is no organization for continuing education for lawyers. So,
you see.
So this is something which is lacking. When we talk of efficiency and we talk of lawyers doing better or lawyers giving more to the courts, more assistance to the court, the lawyer also needs some kind of guidance, some training. This is for, you know, enthusiastic people like you to consider. I'll finish with thanks and expecting Justice Ram Kumar and Roshan Dalvi, Prem Raj to give me their valuable feedback.
Of course, Justice Ram Kumar. Sir,
on the last question, mentioned by you, you are absolutely right, madam. In fact, even if there is some unpleasant exchange between the lawyer and the judge, both the lawyer as well as the judge should not carry any rancor. It should be forgotten then and there. After all, we are all working for the administration of justice. That is our main motto, main target, main objective, both for the judge as well as for the lawyer. There might be some unpleasant exchanges, maybe without any this thing, but both should not nurture any rancor towards each other. That's the best way. Then on the bar bench relationship, I have noticed a growing tendency among some lawyers to call judges, especially judicial officers, or judges of the subordinate judiciary, and praising them for certain orders. Very bad tendency. I think that that should be stopped, because you may not be really interested in praising the judge, but you are appearing every day before that judge, and you maybe this is a part of a flattery or you are that in fact, first of all, a lawyer need not call a sitting judge and exchange pleasantries, particularly praise the judge for some orders, because he is next. Tomorrow he is also appearing before the judge, and it may have some bad tendency also, and some bad motive also. The call may be of due to some bad motive. So I think that that practice. There are some lawyers. In fact, one lawyer himself told me that there are some lawyer friends of his calling judges and. And entering and indulging in this flattery of orders. or maybe with some motive, that no lawyer worth his name or worth his salt should call a judge and exchange such pleasantries. Then on the question of attacking a judgment, of course, nothing wrong if a lawyer is self-proclaimed, a lawyer who is a self-proclaimed jurist appearing in the media and criticizing a judgment, though not the judge. But he should be sure that he knows the law better than the judge himself. there have been situations where the lawyer who criticized a judge or judgment was poorly informed about the law. So whenever a lawyer is bold enough to come before the media as a self-proclaimed jurist, he should be better informed about the law. And he should, of course, he should only highlight the mistakes, the legal errors in the judgment, not the judge. These are all my observations. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Roshan Dalvi, ma'am.
Yes, I would have said that there are the five I's for judges. Integrity, impartiality, intelligence, industry, and independence. I would say that so far as lawyers are concerned, there are no five I's. Lawyers are there naturally to make their profession, their career. And you cannot tell them not to make it. But I would say in short, make money by doing good. Because you can make money by doing bad things also. But you can make money by doing good, ultimately. You can't possibly tell the lawyers not to make money. But please do good. Do no harm. Even to your opponent. That's all. Everything could be covered.
Yeah.
Regarding ethics, I'm sure that there won't be any doubt regarding all the stakeholders, whether it is the lawyers, the judges, or other officials of the justice dispensation machinery, all of them. There is no presumption that some have and some haven't. It is to be inculcated, it has to be developed, and it has to be practiced. If that is done, I'm sure that we have a very good environment for justice dispensation. And regarding questions, I'm sorry. If there is anything to be put, please. Okay, Nitin, do unmute and put the question. Sure.
Thank you, sir. The question was actually about the advocate. Now, let me talk about the lower judiciary department. Let us say the bail has been granted. We have to get the certified copy of the bail or something. There are so many advocates. So the department, so that they get it so fast.
Nitin, you are barely audible. Can you just repeat? You are barely audible. There is some issue with the voice. Yeah.
Yeah. Can you hear me now, sir?
Yeah, you're better.
Yeah. My question was about the advocates. Madam, what we find is, let us say the bail. Then in that case, what happens? Let us say a newcomer advocate is there. He gets the bail and then he goes to the department to get the bail order copy. Unless he pays something that he's not going to get, otherwise they make him wait for a day or 2 days, like that. Because of the other advocates, there they have created a practice that giving the bribe is only the way to get the work done. So in this case, how do we handle such situation? Because that is completely unethical on the part of some people. And if they don't, what happens here is the problem is of the end. Because they have to pay some bribe to them, so they ask more money from the client, and then client is also suffering, and all this happens. Then how do we curb this situation, especially for the advocates who are practicing the obvious field? And if they don't do this now, then they make them wait for a long period of time. Somebody don't want to wait for a long period of time, so they are victim of it, and they don't want to do it, but they do it. This is really happening, what I have also seen and experienced also. Thank you.
Ma'am, the issue appears to be with the office staff or something. That's what Nitin was trying to convey.
Corruption in the judiciary also.
Yeah, that of course.
Can I, although I finished, but it is evoking some thoughts in my mind. Once I was told by my office staff that we are afraid of those lawyers who do not come forward to pay. Because we think this man is, you know, dangerous man. He might put us to trouble. So it's not that if you don't pay, you are always at the losing end. Maybe the other man thinks that, yes, there may be something very important and secret about this man. And if you develop this reputation that this lawyer will not pay, they will not ask you to pay.
But still, to a certain extent, are we condoning such behavior on the part of the officials?
No, not at all. Not at all.
One more question is the...
That is the place where one has to come for justice. If that place itself is corrupt, then where else will the litigant go?
Advocate Raman, he has raised the hand. Shyamala, could you just unmute him?
He can very well do that.
He can.
We enable anybody who wants to unmute to unmute.
He's not doing.
Shankararaman, please.
Sir, good evening to all, sir.
Good evening.
Madam, what about that poverty jurisprudence? You know, poverty jurisprudence envisaged by Sriman V.R. Krishnayar. Kindly enlighten.
Social justice.
But in poverty jurisprudence, later on only after Central Law Commission, he joined as a member, the Legal Aid Service Authority idea was mooted and all you know very well. But what about the pro bono cases concept? For ethics of the lawyers. I heard that even Mrs. Hillary Clinton, one among the 100 advocates in the United States, she got 10 to 15% pro bono cases when she was an advocate. So towards it, in the point of ethics also, lawyers, we must have the pro bono cases for fit and clients. That's my question.
No, what is the question?
The question that you have put is that is taking up pro bono cases part of this ethical duty or a ethical behavior on the part of the
lawyer? Yes, exactly. If it is part and parcel of nowadays, the young advocates for it.
No, there is compulsion, but it is certainly good. There is no compulsion, but certainly it is good. It's an opportunity to do real public service.
But to me, earlier, even now it's a noble profession, but now it has become a business. Even recent youngsters, budding lawyers, they are not having any attitude for conducting pro bono cases and other things. That's my question, madam. For the young advocates, budding lawyers.
Right.
So for that aspect, your suggestions and advice for the young advocates. It's also a part of the ethics.
Well, I have no comments to offer. Ask the other seniors.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you, Shyam.
Ma'am, I believe there are no more questions put in the box, but may just one doubt or one thought that has just crossed the mind of many would be, you made a statement that a lawyer is an officer of the court. he holds a public, it should be deemed that he holds a public office. During the COVID times, almost all the officers of the court are being paid tax, I mean a salary with the taxpayers' money. What about the lawyer? If he is to act as an officer of the court, he should be deemed to be a public officer unless and until there is something quid pro quo or something akin to, I mean, some payment, some sort of solace. Just requiring some section to act as if they are something without any benefits. Is it okay?
A pertinent question.
Yeah. I think Justice Ramkumar is answering your concern.
Sir, said it's a pertinent question.
I only said the question is pertinent. See, after all, the welfare measures, it's a time for us to revisit the welfare measures, because we never had anticipated such a bad COVID time. So, taking this into account, we should definitely have a relook at the advocate welfare measures. Every government should think of it.
Thank you, sir. Now, over to Prem.
Well, madam, it is a wonderful lecture. It is a wonderful talk. And once again, I would thank Justice Roshan Dalvi also for introducing you to the platform. And regarding Shyam Madam's question, I would tell you one thing. You said the bar, it's a part of the bench. I mean, the officers of the court are the lawyers. So why not we get salary? Now, to the contrary, let me ask you like this. There has been a saying as old as the profession itself, that the court and the counsel are two wheels of the chariot of justice. They are two sides of the same coin. So if the lawyer gets his professional fee, is there any need to share it with the judges? Take it that way? You can put it this way.
Frame, the issue is not that. That philosophical side, everything, if you want a debate on that, we'll have it on another day, but not on this platform. But still, whether there is work or not, you're expert of an income. Whereas a lawyer, he gets his professional income when there is work. You open the courts, let me come in, let me do the work. Don't keep it closed.
Okay, I'll answer you. The bench and the bar, they are two arms of the same machinery. And why it is said that the advocate is an officer of the court? Because unless the bench and the bar works harmoniously, justice cannot be properly administered through the courts of law. See, we have seen lapses occur from the part of the lawyers. We have seen lapses occur from the part of the judicial officers. And this, in fact, would stiffen the relationship itself. Right? Because sometimes to use certain expressions, even among lawyers or the judges, it may not be palatable in that particular relationship. And you just see, many of the judges, they expect good behavior from the lawyers, saying that it goes a long way for their attempt to acquire the justice from the court for their clients, which principle we all have been following. It is not a mere scholarly approach of a lawyer that plays an important role in achieving your success. Rather, the good conduct of the lawyer also helps and plays effectively, right? On the other hand, of course, behavior of judges towards lawyer, doesn't that play an important role in the administration of justice? That too has to be there. We have a Karnataka High Court judgment, which says that if a judge who disrespects a lawyer, that judge also is not to be respected. We have a Karnataka High Court ruling in the ISKCON case. Now, kindly see, this particular relationship, let us leave alone that officer of the court and whether you are entitled for payment. See, what's the relation between the bench and the bar? It means a very, very, very delicate relationship. It allows an advocate to be very firm. Even though you are submitting, the submission has to be very forceful.
We are moving away from the topic.
I am coming to it. See, you can see from there are two, three judgments on the question you asked.
The very simple question is, I'll, no, it's my question. I'll reframe the question so that it'll be easy for you to address it. Do you, advocate that there should be some sort of assistance to the lawyers during this crisis period or not?
Simple. During the crisis period, of course, the lawyers should be assisted, but not by the not by saying that they are officers of the court. Let me tell you, we have our bar council. We have been paying the welfare fund. First of all, the bar council has to make some initiative. Right or wrong? We have been electing members. Like
the stakeholders of bar council also. Now, in this platform, I don't think there is any officials of the bar council. Let us.
We have to, because see,
we will do one thing. We will have this debate with them also included in one session, wherein the role of our statutory body, because we are today on the ethics of lawyers. We should have a session on the duties, responsibilities of our statutory body, which is the bar council. Are they performing it properly or not? We'll reserve our comments for that.
Okay, when we are on ethics, I think that question also cannot relate to ethics. Why? Because bar council members, or the bar council being the statutory body, they have to take the initiative, according to me. They have to take the initiative. Because it's a highly debatable question. It's a highly pertinent question. At the same time, the thing is that, but for the bar council, see, what can the judges do?
You got an exceptionally good 3 judges today among us for the deliberations. We are thankful for that. And
because judges cannot direct the bar council, you do like this to the lawyers right now. Because it's for the bar council to do that, actually. Let the bar council initiate something. And if not, somebody has to file a writ petition before the High Court. Let us see what will be the outcome.
Absolutely. Let us see the message reaches our statutory body also.
No, the that writ petition would be dismissed in limine.
I don't know. Supreme, the kind permission of all, that brings us to the end of the 89th session with a wonderful, insightful lecture and a thought-provoking one with examples and challenging us with scenarios regarding ethics for lawyers. Tomorrow at in the 90th session, we'll be having an overview of Law of Limitation by Justice K.T. Shankaran. Thank you, Justice Manju Goyal, for that wonderful presentation. Justice Roshan Dalvi for introducing the speaker to the topic, to the platform, and being present. Justice Ramkumar sir for patiently being with us till now, and each and every one of you, wonderful persons, wonderful participants, for being part of this journey. Tomorrow, we'll have an oversight or overview of the Law of Limitation by Justice K.T. Shankaran. And it's really happy to note that we'll be completing our 90th session, or we'll be reaching at our 90th session tomorrow. So till we meet again tomorrow at 3:30, please do take care and lead a life of pure, refined ethics. Thank you.